Welcome to SHA 2017. Tonight we have Barbara Wimmer, and she's going to tell us about science fiction in the present. So maybe it's science fiction. A little bit of entertainment and showbiz, but also some more serious stuff like privacy and security. So give a welcome and a warm applause for Barbara Wimmer.
Hello, everybody. I hope that you will enjoy the next 45 minutes. The topic is best of IoT fails. And actually, I wrote a song about this called Smart Lies. And it goes like this: look how smart we are. Sensors everywhere, because we care. We connect ourselves with devices and can't see the upcoming crisis. Apps for lamps, sensors for flowers, fridges send signals, TVs get widgets. Everything's connected and we unplug our brain, but lives are affected with stupidity and pain. Welcome to the Internet of Things. You all should know that I'm not a security researcher, but a journalist. So everybody that expects to get any details about the things I'm presenting, please don't. I can't explain you the details. It should only be a presentation of more funny examples and a little bit of mix with science fiction. I also talked to a couple of science fiction authors that are going to be mentioned in quotes in advance of this talk. And well, the Internet of Things can be the connected coffee machine and the connected vibrator. One example is a smart coffee maker that can connect with other things, like even fitness and sleeping trackers via IFTT. And so it can automatically mix you a strong coffee when you had a short night, as an example. And actually, the numbers of how many connected things are expected in the near future is collected by Gartner at the beginning of this year. In January 2007, they said that 8.3 million connected devices are already around, and in 2020 we will got 20.4 million connected devices. So we are getting a huge increase in a couple of years ahead of us, and we are already having a lot of devices out there. And the problem is that most of the devices that are out there are not really secure or privacy friendly yet. And there is actually a little bit of sign that they will in the future, but not too much. Apart from the Internet of Things, there's the Internet of Shit, which is actually, you all know the Twitter account, Internet of Shit, but there is some toilet IoT sensor out there by an Israeli startup named OutSense, and it has a display at the toilet with a box of sensors attached to the seat, with a tiny Intel computer that connects to a mobile app that helps analyze excretions. And the stool analysis data is sent into the cloud. From there, it can be used to manage health and nutritional and stress issues. Actually, there are certain diseases around, that where this sensor could really be helpful. Like there are diseases like morbus Crohn or colitis ulcerosa. These people, they kind of really can use this kind of sensor, but the startup aims not at these people, but aims at the normal people that just want to connect everything and get better health out of their stool analyzers. And they really are people around that send their data to the cloud. Well, you all know the Internet of Shit Twitter account, probably. If not, now you know it. A site that collects every kind of IoT fails. And apart from the Internet of Shit, we got the Internet of Dongs, which is the name of a project that hacks sex toys to keep your intimate life private with this website. And this is how the website looks like. And there's a collective. I didn't speak to them yet, so I can't present you any more details about this project. But they are actually getting supported by Pornhub because they got equipment sent by them to test. And actually, they work together with the vendors. And the vendors, they really fix the security issues they report. So actually, I think this is one of the good examples in the scene that is really helpful to make IoT devices better in the future. But we all want to know what could possibly go wrong. This is actually a question everybody who is an author asks themselves every day when they write on a plot. It's like, oh, what could possibly go wrong? But actually, this question also society should ask themselves or ourselves before we connect everything. The science fiction author of Lord of Things, in German, this book is called Herr der Dinge, Lord of Things. It's a German science fiction author. He thinks that IoT is the new recipe for a new range of disaster plots. I think he's right. And actually, we already have some, because there are thousands of fails around already in terms of privacy, security, updates, and planning. Actually, a use case is essential for an Internet of Things product, and not every thing is actually having one. For example, there is this startup called Juicero. You've probably heard of it. It was funded with $120 million. It's an internet-connected juice machine, and it was sold at the beginning for $700, and it didn't have any use case because the fruit could be pressed by hand easier, and there was no use of the internet connection at all. And actually, this is a fail in planning. And, well, now I want to get a little bit back in the timeline. Because I presented the numbers of things connected in 2020, but there are like already a lot of devices, and at the beginning nobody did care about security. The first hackers showed that already in 2013 at Black Hat. And in 2014, there was the first fridge around caught sending spam emails in a botnet attack. And it was the first documented attack of this kind. And IoT has been used as part of that, sending over 750,000 spam mails. And this was just the beginning. This is also a nice quote. The early 2000s, web security called, and they want their lack of security back. Well, 2016 we had this big Mirai. I am sure I don't tell you anything new with this, but I can't let it out because it was really an important attack and a botnet with approximately 100,000 unsecured IoT devices took an integral internet infrastructure provider partially offline. And the people, actually also the media, did notice that mainly because Netflix and Twitter disappeared offline from the internet for a short time. And like suddenly everybody was, oh, why? Netflix is not working. Twitter is not working. What? Hackers? Oh my God. So it was Mirai and they didn't really know what was going on. Because, but you probably were not surprised at all. it also disrupted Deutsche Telekom and TalkTalk in UK. And Bruce Schneier said, expect more attacks like the one against DIN in the coming year. So I'm also sure that we will expect, we will see much more attacks in the future because the devices out now are not really improved yet. But you're probably all waiting for the funny fails now because that was like more serious kind of stuff. So let's talk about this nice little car. You all know it from the film Cars. It's the Ultimate Lightning McQueen. And it's a toy now. Sold by Sphero for €349. And this little car got in our, where I work, we tested this, and actually it took 1 hour to even start it because of a software update. Before you can use it, it takes 1 hour until it even starts working with anything. And it can only be run by an app and not, it doesn't have a physical button on the car, but only runs by app. And well, and it also has a camera integrated. That was wrong. It doesn't have a camera. It has a microphone, sorry. And when you want to watch the film Cars, this little car can sit next to you and comment on the film. And actually, you have to turn on the microphone with this app that also controls the car. And then it can comment on the film. Oh, sorry, that was too early. Don't look at this now. I don't want to talk about the car anymore and not about the coffee machine, but a different example about update processing that could probably go wrong a bit. There's also a story about a porn film producer that gets regularly sent vibrators to test in the before they might be useful to integrate into films. And she actually got this tool, which is also very expensive, $400, she said. And She unpacked it and started it by an app, and then it started to vibrate. And then the app was saying, this tool needs a software update right now, and the app couldn't, the vibrator couldn't be turned off for 30 minutes. And it was standing like here next to her on her desk and was vibrating the whole time for 30 minutes, and she was getting kind of scared because she's not really used to that, and there was no off button as well as at this thing. And this is actually, and it what I wanted to say with this example and the last one is that there are very expensive toys around that just fail with having the most essential button, a physical off button, and are connected to the internet. Well, yeah. So what you see here is the coffee machine. We were by the coffee machine before, but this is a special funny case from Germany, because there was a fabric in Germany that did not connect the coffee machines to its own isolated Wi-Fi network, but the internal control room of the chemical fabric where the processes were made. So the operator that did not contact the support about his monitoring system not working, and he forgot to mention the coffee machines were showing the same error. So the coffee machines actually affected the whole chemical fabric, and it was a ransomware attack. And of course, the system was running on Windows XP, but the operator said that he wanted to upgrade it, but it's not possible due to some law stuff. And of course, the problem was fixed, but the guy responsible for that was really angry because the vendor of the coffee machines just did make some mistakes. This was also not the first example of network connecting failure. You maybe remember the vending machine that was attacked by their own, not the vending machine, but the university, that was attacked by their vending machine and their light bulbs. It was about 5 months ago, and the firewall analysis identified over 5,000 discrete systems making hundreds of DNS lookups every 15 minutes. And these machines were also connected to the network for easy management. So the whole university network was for the students, for the teachers, for the machines were all the same. So that's why this problem could arise, and the botnet could spread from device to device by brute force forcing the default passwords. And actually, there would have only been two solutions to solve it: either to get rid of all the machines, which isn't actually a solution for a university. So the university used a packet sniffer to intercept a clear text malware password for a compromised IoT device. And with these passwords, the developers were able to write a script to remove the infection across all devices at once. There's also another dildo. Well, sorry. It's all about coffee machines, dildos, vending machines, whatever. So there's actually a dildo around that is a vulnerable Wi-Fi dildo camera endoscope. And this is especially funny because it's a Wi-Fi access point as well. And it connects hidden functionality to connect itself to Skype and to save videos automatically to a network file share. The device's default password is easy. And if you use this and you change to the, you forget to change the default login credentials, well, you will have a few more players than expected that might watch the newest video of it. This is how it looks like. And actually, this was done by pen test partners, and this is the disclosure timeline. And they didn't get any response. And then they, after a certain time, they did release this to the internet. Okay, then I have a few examples of update failures. I don't think I will need to tell a lot with the couple of things here. So we talked about updates before, but of course there are things updating that are actually currently in use. And it's really not helpful if somebody wants a drink now and can't get one because the machine is updating. This is also valid for a ceiling fan. And light bulbs. Well, there are a lot of light bulbs around that need updates, and it takes a long time. And if you can't turn on the light for 30 minutes and sit in your dark room, that might not really be helpful. And it gets worse if you want to use an elevator. And the elevator is doing a weekly virus scan instead of bringing you up to the floor. I mean, if you're a disabled person, that is not funny, but it's serious. But updates, of course, are important. Nobody, even if the Internet of Things stuff is updating itself, it can be secured, but there are so many devices around that can't even get any updates. So actually, it's funny to think about the fails when it takes such a long time. But on the end, it could be helpful because this way the devices can be secured. Otherwise, they might never get secured. So I asked myself, as an author and journalist, does technology beat science fiction nowadays? And I asked a couple of science fiction authors around, and they did have quite different answers. Everybody has his or her own view around. Bruce Sterling answered me that's like asking, is reality stranger than fiction? And of course, reality is stranger than fiction, because fiction needs to be plausible while reality is real. So everything an author is getting written down needs to be plausible, while everything that is just happening because it's happening. I also talked to Johannes Grenzfurtner from the Vienna collective Monochrome, and he said in some respects, yes, I would never have thought that I would see self-driving cars in my lifetime, and they are only 5 to 10 years away from widespread everyday usage. The science fiction author Anne Leckie said, I'm not sure I'd say that science fiction is primarily about technology as such. I think science fiction isn't about technology as much as it's about how we deal with technology, which is also a really good point. And the Andreas Eschbach I quoted before, I don't know if you can read this, but I'm reading it for you. Science fiction depends on scientific and technology contexts the reader can understand in order to follow the implications of the story. But today's technology is far beyond common understandability, so it has become almost impossible to build a plot on these things anymore, with the result that science fiction is mostly backdated. Spaceships, aliens, laser weapons, and galactic empires ad infinitum. Mark Ellsberg, who wrote the book Blackout, also an Austrian author. He is saying nope, or it depends on the fiction. So there's not really one answer, there are many answers around. And when will the time come when a coffee machine says no? You are not allowed to drink anymore, otherwise your insurance policy will be canceled. This is actually a fictional example, but we don't need any fiction right now. We have Roomba, which is the iRobot, and the iRobot, is a robot by iRobot that is making our homes, is mapping our homes. And the CEO, Colin Angel, did say he wants to share this data from the maps to improve the further of smart home technology. So actually, Roombas want to do something which is even allowed yet in the terms of service and the privacy policy, because everybody clicks yes and nobody thinks what he's doing. But he's not allowed to sell it yet. So he's just allowed to share it, but not sell it. And there was a big discussion about it because he actually wanted to sell it to other vendors. And actually there was a big, big media hype around that. So people were crying, oh no, we don't want our data to be sold to other things which are recorded in your own private room. But actually, this will be happening in the near future, I think. And we have to ask ourselves what we do want as a society. Do we really want an internet of unsecured things connected to everything, or do we want to have a secure internet? And is it maybe not important to connect everything when there isn't even a use case for it? Or how should we deal with it? There are a little bit of answers yet, but you could do some standards which are working in other parts of the security stuff, but not for the IoT. There are no standards yet. And also, like, vendors could be punished if they make unsecure devices, and that would also be a possible solution. But I don't see actually right now in which direction it is going to get. And I thank you for your attention.
Question?
Yes. Okay. If there are any.
Yeah. I think it's good.
Do you hear me? Yes. So for the next minutes, we have a question and answering opportunity. So Is there somebody who would like to have a question? Bad light. Nobody? Okay, then let's have a warm applause for Barbara Wilmer. Thank you.